Hello YouTube viewers, welcome to my show Rocket Monday. In today's episode, we're gonna take a look at BFR 2.0 versus SLS Block 2. So let's dive right into it. First, what are these things? Well, it's super heavy lift vehicle. Then the question becomes, why the heck do we need super heavy lift? One simple answer: economy of scale. Basically, the bigger you send, the cheaper it becomes, even with the same technology. Economy of scale, basically dollar per kilogram goes down. So we got that. Second, for space missions, it becomes very crucial. If we use something big that we can send with higher speed, we can increase the scope of our mission. Like, how far can we go? How large can we build? These things are directly proportional to the size of your launch vehicle. If you have a small launch vehicle which is very cheap, but let's say you have to send 500 modules to build one large thing, you're not gonna build that. But let's say you need to send only 50, then it's doable. That's more or less International Space Station level. So for that reason, it's not just that cost matters, size also plays a very, very crucial role. Now, to give you a context of size, understand it in this way: International Space Station, the largest man-made space structure that we have, has pressurized volume, as in where people can live without a spacesuit, of around 916 cubic meter. It's big, it's basically like a jumbo jet, but it's not too big. It's not comparable anywhere, shape or form, to your house or like a big building. It's very cramped. Now the only saving grace is that because of zero gravity, the headroom is actually usable. So that's the pressurized volume of that. Now BFR and SLS both have a different configuration. Each configuration will allow different sort of cubic meter. So for these sort of reason, we really want big. The bigger we make it, the less steps that we have to take to eventually colonizing the moon. Now, so let's look at our contender. First contender, you have to understand, NASA is gonna pay for the mission no matter what happens. Either it's SpaceX or ULA, NASA is the one forfeiting the bill. Understand this very thoroughly. Even if SpaceX builds the rocket themselves, which most likely it's not gonna happen because they are already getting money from millionaires, and once they demonstrate the technology, as in the engines have been tested, hop testing has been performed, NASA will start dumping in money, same way they did with earlier days of SpaceX, where they started to dump profits of $400 million. And basically, if they did that, then SpaceX can take out loan. Even if NASA is not paying them directly, if NASA says, okay, we're gonna use your launch vehicle, that's like a ticket booking, and on based on that, then SpaceX can take out a big loan. So one way or the another, NASA is paying for it. So basically, public is paying for it one way or the another. Then we come to the SpaceX, which is offering BFR as a Mars mission provider. Then we come to SLS joint venture, which SLS is built by ULA. Basically, built by ULA is not correct to say, because it's a joint venture. So ULA is handling everything, but components, on the component level, the component is being handled by Boeing, Northrop Grumman, and Aerojet Rocketdyne. Basically, the biggest of them is Boeing. So Boeing is handling most of the things, and ULA is handling the space related thing, basically permit, launch pads and things of that nature. So one side we have one thing, basically SpaceX is building BFR, that's it. And the other end we have ULA trying to build its launch vehicle with using these three providers. So this is our providers. Then we come to BFR. Now you can check my video about BFR here, latest updates. And so let's do a quick rundown on this. The biggest factor of this is fully reusable. Basically, this thing and the booster comes back. This whole rocket is not use and throw. It's basically reused upwards of 50 to 100 times. So that's the very crucial aspect. Then we come to the aspect that really makes it unique, is that it can do what we call space refueling, basically orbital refueling. You can send a fuel tanker in orbit to dock with this. They're gonna dock from rear end, and once they do the docking, they can transfer the fuel. So nothing fancy about it, it's very simple. They're just gonna have a fuel tanker model specifically built, so it can recharge it in space, in orbit, basically low Earth orbit. Now, in the earlier days, their concept was calling for 5 to 6 refueling. for that interplanetary transport vehicle. Then the BFR, we never got a concrete number, so it was assumed it's gonna be like 3 to 4. This may be able to drop it down to 2 or maybe 1. One is pushing it, but I'm pretty sure they can get it done to 2. Basically, they're gonna launch the main ship, then they're gonna, you know, refuel it using 2 other refueler tanks. So they're gonna have orbital refueling. Now the size of it, like the payload volume or the size that they're gonna sell to NASA, like this is my size, build whatever you want to build in it, is 1000 cubic meter. Basically it's big, it's bigger than ISS, but be mindful, ISS, that volume is usable volume. In this, it will shrink because of course you have to put life support, you have to put radiation shielding, you have to put a water reclaimer and you know, air scrubbers and things of that nature, so that volume will keep shrinking. How much, that depends on how well integrated it is. If it's integrated well enough, we may end up more or less the same amount in terms of, like, you know, usable space. But like, let's say 1000 is a very good point because they can't exceed this volume. They will always be under this volume. So they may actually able to achieve upwards of 900 cubic meter in terms of usable volume. Basically this will be, this have more leg room, head room, hand room than ISS. But this is very crucial, this is less than SLS, and that it has a rocket engine that is using methane. Now many of my last video has commented that methane, when you burn it at very high temperature, it creates what we call free hydrogen ions. Basically you are burning your methane with oxygen, but you are overflowing the oxygen. Basically you are sending more fuel than oxygen. Now this will create free hydrogen, and that way you will get more benefit. That's absolutely true. However, it is still a compromise. It's not gonna be like, you know, 100% to a liquid hydrogen rocket. The liquid hydrogen rocket always will have higher specific impulse. As you can see, they themselves are claiming upwards of 330 seconds of specific impulse, which is not bad, but it's also nowhere near of a hydrogen system. Basically that means if they send it, like without refueling, if they just send the rocket, it's gonna take longer to travel far. So basically, let's say you have Jupiter mission, this will take much longer to go there compared to SLS. Now their principle of operation, how they are going about it, is very simple. It's one ship to rule them all. Basically they are making one thing that can take care of everything. Basically this thing itself is gonna go to Mars, not only orbit the Mars, land on Mars, come back from Mars, then land on Earth. So one thing to do it all. Basically many of you who have remembered the Saturn project, there was a specific module. You had a transport module which, you know, carried the crew. Then you had a crew return capsule, basically that handled the landing to Earth. Then you had lunar landing vehicle that landed. Then you have lunar ascent module that handled you know, launching from basically moon surface. In here they have just one thing that can take care of it all. Now it's not a magical concept, it's just a tricky concept to handle, specifically because of the fuel consumption. So if you can balance it properly, it is doable. Physics is not saying that you can't do this, but it is a tricky aspect. So this is their philosophy, this is what they are aiming for. Now we come to its competition, SLS, basically Space Launch System. Now the biggest side effect it has is basically expendable launch vehicle. It's just gonna be use and throw, use and throw. So cost wise I'm not even gonna try to compare this versus SpaceX. SpaceX is a private company and ULA is running on an old government principle, which let's just say is very inefficient with money. So on money term, there is no competition, flat out there is no competition. Then we come to the aspect, this is solving the problem of orbital refueling by doing what we call orbital docking. Many of you know this project is an upgraded version of old NASA project, which was known as Project Constellation. Basically that was their replacement for Space Shuttle, and that was the whole idea. Basically they're gonna assemble everything in space and then go to Mars. That was their approach, build spaceship in space. That was the approach. They're not gonna have one module that, you know, does everything. So basically they are going back to Saturn V. Only difference is, instead of launching everything using one super heavy rocket, they're gonna launch different parts. Now this, if they use super heavy rocket, they have the benefit, they can build much bigger spaceship in this space with, you know, much more safety, redundancy, and flat out might have like 2 to 3 crew return vehicle, 2 to 3, like basically how space station has it. Like right now in any given time, International Space Station has at least 2 vehicle that can allow, you know, emergency return to surface. and it has much bigger payload capacity in block 2. Now, payload capacity in terms of size is around 1800 cubic meter. Now, that is significantly bigger than what we have in terms of SpaceX. That means the whole space that is there, it can be built in such a way that you will actually get more usable, basically more pressurized volume that you can put your astronauts in. You can easily exceed 1500 cubic meter, and there are some designs that use inflatable. Basically, they're gonna have a core. The core will have all the electronics, all the doodads that they need for life support, and the outside will expand. Now, because of the large volume, they can actually do this. This will be flat out impossible for SpaceX to do, simply because their volume is limited. And this is the core reason the NASA actually demanded for a 10 meter fairing. This will be done by a 10 meter fairing. That is why that is requested. It's not there like, you know, oh, nobody's gonna send something that big. It was built on a request. The design was built on a request. Will they actually gonna build it? It's politics. I do not know. So, and given the fact that it is using hydrogen as its primary means of propulsion, it has much higher specific impulse, basically 462 seconds. And it's already there, it's already tested in vacuum, or the engine has already been tested. So, all things considered, this has higher specific impulse, meaning you can send much bigger payload, much heavier payload, because this not only, you know, limited to 100 ton, it can go upwards of 130 to 150 ton. So not only it can send heavier payload, it can also send bigger payload. And because of higher specific impulse, it will travel farther and faster. And not to mention, because in Constellation project, they realized the idea that if we really want to go to Mars, either we're gonna use nuclear propulsion or we're gonna use ion propulsion. Of course, I couldn't find any diagram for that ion propulsion. The best one I know is that's being tested in LOBG. So the idea is very simple. Ion propulsion does not provide you significant speed advantage if you are going very close by. Like going to the moon, ion engines are useless. But if you're going to Mars, you can cut down your travel time by half or even more using solar panels. So all things considered, this is the idea of SpaceX, basically SLS, pardon me. So SLS is gonna build a thing in space. So they're gonna have one giant module. That 10 meter fairing will be used to carry one big chunk of space habitat. Then they're gonna put propulsion module, then they're gonna put other modules. So this is a different approach than SpaceX. So, but again, the cost is the biggest hurdle here. This is, many people also call it, you can check my detailed video about SLS here. And many people also call it Senate launch system. So for that reason, please check out that video. Then we come to the actual pros and cons of this different approach, not of the cost itself, because I told you, like, it's politics involved into this, and ULA will not make their cost go down, because again, already recently, a few days ago, a report was published where everybody was blaming Boeing for their handling of this project. It should not be delayed by this much. Right now, the first unmanned test supposed to happen at 2022. It's delayed beyond all belief. So people are getting kind of frustrated with that, but all things considered, they have different approach. So in this video, I want to actually bring forward the idea that different approaches have different benefits. First, one approach that we have, one to rule them all, has the advantage of cost, because you have to build one thing that can take care of everything. Now, of course, it will be costly, it will be complicated. You have to build an engine that can be reliably reignited many times. You're gonna have a system where you can handle the re-entry burn multiple times. You're gonna need a system that can handle everything with high G forces. Basically, if you put giant rocket in International Space Station, it's gonna fall apart, because it's not built to handle very high G force. But BFR has to be built in such a way that BFR ship can handle high G forces much more comfortably. So this approach has the cost on its side. However, as you can see, this is the LOBG that you can check my video here. The LOBG approach is very simply, it's a test ground for a Constellation project. Now, of course, Constellation project is now SLS. So they're gonna test what we call ion propulsion module. So the idea of that is that if you go to Mars and if you ignite ion propulsion engine, it has specific impulse of ludicrously high number. Like, you can easily get 1500 seconds to 2000 to 5000. So mileage is very high. However, the consequence of that is it's very low thrust. So it's like, if you fire it on Earth, you're not gonna even feel that it's pushing you. However, in space, where you trigger this engine and keep it running for, let's say, months on end, it's not like a chemical engine where you start it and boom, it's done. It takes time. It will keep running. It will be continuously running for like months on end. So when you do that, on the other end of that time frame, like say you triggered it for 1 month, you will be traveling significantly higher, at significantly higher velocity than you will do by any chemical means. And this is the crucial reason why the LOPG has that ion propulsion module. They're gonna test the technology out, whether it actually works in space continuously 24/7 into 365. So we have done ion propulsions in past also, but never in this scale and scope. So this approach of basically SLS, that is, you know, specialized module, it can be done today. That's the best aspect of it. Like if NASA starts to build today, they can just sell today. Now, BFR cannot do this for one crucial reason. In my video about BFR, I specified that BFR's, all things aside from cost and timelines, all things aside, they were taking the fact that they're gonna go to Mars and they're gonna make fuel like it was a given. Like, you know, they're just gonna put a water hose, on dry ice lake or methane lake, and you're just gonna, you know, get your fuel. That is very difficult to do on Mars. Not only the atmosphere is ludicrously thin, so even if you need to extract CO2, which Mars has a lot of, but you're gonna spend a lot of energy trying to extract that. To test these sort of things out, basically to test in situ utilization, NASA is building what we call Mars Curiosity Rover 2.0, basically Mars 2020 rover, and it has a specific module built for this reason alone, that is going to figure out how much energy it takes to, you know, actually extract things, not mathematical, not guesswork or things like that. Basically actually go to Mars and figure out how much energy they have to spend, and it will try to make oxygen, and it will give a very good idea, concrete idea, what kind of energy level we are talking about to, you know, make propellant. It's not impossible, it's just the fact of how much energy do you need, because the biggest problem is solar panels are useless on Mars, not because a sun doesn't shine, it's simply because A, the storm could happen that can last upwards of 2 months, B, what you're gonna do at night, C, because Mars is so far off, it has like 1/4 of the solar energy or solar flux you're talking about. So now of course some people say it's half, some people say it's 1/4, basically it's very low. So even if you have a very large solar panel that is giving you 200 kilowatt of power around moon and earth, it's not going to give you 200 kilowatt of power on Mars orbit. It's going to drop significantly. For this reason, NASA is also developing kilowatt nuclear reactor, and that will be NASA's way of handling the power requirement. Now BFR cannot do that because SpaceX does not have the clearance to build nuclear technology yet. They might get it in future, but yet they don't have it. So this is crucial. This is make or break for BFR. If this figures out like what kind of energy we are talking about, that will tell SpaceX to figure out the size of their solar panels, like how many they need. Like, do they need 1 square hectare or they need 10 square hectare of solar panels? So we really should be watching out for that. So this is what I want you to understand. It's not that space launch system is completely useless. On cost, yes it is, because it's government, but everything other than that, it's not built as a complete idiot architecture. The architecture is very efficient on what it has. Now BFR is also awesome, as many of you know, but it also has some hurdles, like biggest being that in situ utilization. Without that mission, we'll have no actual clue how much energy we need to make propellant on Mars. We can do it. If you have a big ass nuclear reactor that provides gigawatts of power, you can do that in few days, but we don't have that yet. So this is why I want you to take a closer look at the approach of SLS versus BFR. I hope you like my presentation on SpaceX versus BFR, and if you liked it, please like, share it amongst your friend and subscribe. If you didn't, don't worry about it, dislike it, and I would urge you to leave a comment what you wanna see in the next episode of Rocket Monday. And as always, thanks for watching.